presentation, right? I work for Lenaro. I'm an Android coding engineer, as you can see from my title. So I will be covering Android coding basics. I won't be covering coding into mobile phones like what Sandwich and Watts do. I'll be covering how you code Android on development boards. Development boards means a bigger board or any kind of development boards which you are aware of. Okay. So, but these are not just limited to any particular board. These are very well, you know, applicable for mobile phones also. So let's get started. I'll just go through the agenda for this session. I'll be covering the Android software stack. I'll be covering what all different layers Android software stack consists of. Next important topic is Android open source project, AOSP. I'll tell you how to get the code, what the code consists of, and how is the code structure for AOSP, and how to build the configurations, how to configure the builds, and how to configure the runtime options. Then I'll be covering Android boot process, and lastly, I'll be covering Android debugging and troubleshooting. So we'll start with Android software stack. So take some time to go through the layers. At the lowest layer, we have Linux kernel. Linux kernel is there's a saying. It says that it goes like, if you are capable of running Linux on a device, then you can very well run Android on it. But it's just a saying. It doesn't work most of the time because it has some memory requirements. Linux you can run starting from 32 MB of RAM to it goes up to 1 GB and more. But if anyone has attended yesterday's talk regarding memory optimization, so in that talk, Mr. Satish talks about what is the minimum memory your system should be having just to run Android smoothly. But yes, Linux kernel is something which is the building block of Android. Then second layer is Android hardware abstraction layers. Android hardware abstraction layer is that part of code, that part of software stack, which talks in between, which helps your Android framework to talk to Linux kernel and eventually the hardware. Then we have got libraries and runtime libraries, your media framework, your core libraries, Dalvik VM. Then starts the Android application framework, where you can see all the system services, your media servers, your network daemons, service managers, everything is a part of application framework. On top of it, you will find Android applications. It could be anything. I've just listed down a few of them: home, dialer, camera. So how it works is that once you start your application, it has to go through the Android frameworks. It has to go through a couple of services or more services. Then it will talk to your Linux kernel or hardware through your hardware abstraction layer and this middleware libraries. I've also put a small firmware binary section here, which is essentially, it's not a part of the Linux kernel, it's not a part of your hardware abstraction layer. This is something which you load or which your code loads onto the hardware directly. Now, I'm talking about Android open source project. First thing is how to set up your development machines or how to set up your host and target machines. If you people are aware of Android mailing lists and all these Android official channels, communication channels, there's an Android engineer called JBQ. He recently shifted a mail on Android building list where he mentioned that what is the requirement for ICS. If you are planning to port ICS or if you are planning to use ICS and build it for your systems, then what is the requirement is going to be. So I have listed down this section of that mail, which says that it's going to be about 6 GB of download, 25 GB of disk space if you do a single build. Now, what he meant by single build is that AOSP comes with a couple of targets or a couple of builds. Default builds, I'm talking about. Plus, you can add your own builds. So here, 25 GB is only for a single build. Now, 80 GB of disk space to do all the builds. default BIOS which comes with the part of AOSP, 16 GB RAM, and then he mentioned that how much time it took for him to build ICS on his dual core machine. This is mainly from the host machine point of view. Host, okay. When I'm talking about a host machine, I'm talking about your development machine. And when I'm talking about a target machine, then I'm talking about your development boards or your machines on which you are planning to run Android. So the second point is initializing Android build environment. 64-bit Ubuntu 10.04 machine. It is officially Google says that it has to be 64-bit Ubuntu machine to run to build AOSP, but there are a couple of workarounds available through which you can build Ubuntu, you can build Android on 32-bit machines as well. Then other dependent packages are Sun Java is a core of Android. That is something which you have to admit. So this is a dependency. Git, build essentials. It is a huge list. If you go to this link, this is a link. This is a hyperlink. So if you go to this link, you will find all the dependencies plus the commands which you have to run on your host machine to met all these dependencies. If you are using Ubuntu or a Debian based machine, then these are going to be apt-get install. For your Fedora and RPM based machine, you have to find corresponding targets. Now the point is AOSP code access. So here I will be covering what AOSP consists of, how to download AOSP code, and what is this repo tool. Now AOSP consists of multiple independent projects maintained by Git. Now what does this mean? Git, if you people are not aware of Git, Git is a code versioning system which is vastly used in Linux world. So AOSP is not a single project. If you see AOSP code, if you have downloaded any of these AOSP codes, you will find that it's a set of hundreds of independent projects, Git projects. So what Android does is Android release a tool called repo. Repo is essentially a shell script. It is a wrapper over all. It's a wrapper over Git. So what it does is it downloads each individual project from that repository, so that you don't have to do it manually or one by one. Because as I've told you, those are independent projects. You can download them individually as well. Initially Android AOSP was hosted at kernel.org, but due to some recent events, they have to move to the new location. It's android.googlesource.com. Currently, you cannot do a web review. That means that you cannot check out, you cannot go through the code over web. So you have to download it and then you can do it. And since web review is not available, you cannot. Gerrit is also not available. Gerrit is a tool through which AOSP maintains its patches. So if you are planning to contribute something, if you have a feature or a patch or a bug fix in mind, so what you have to do is you have to set up this Gerrit at your local machine, and then you have to push it to correct channels. And how it essentially works is, how Gerrit works is that you specify the number of reviewers you want it to approve. One reviewer or two reviewers, whatever it is. I'm not going into that much detail because of that thesis. Okay, then the last thing is manifest file. Of all the application developers here, AOSP or Android project manifest file is different from a application manifest file. Application manifest file is something where you specify your resources, your permissions, and your other things. In this AOSP manifest file, what we specify the Git location. We specify the location of projects from where I'm going to download. I'm going to specify the branch from where I'm going to check out, or the commit ID which I'm going to check out. I can just show you how it looks like. This is how it looks like. You can see this is the Git location. Okay. And let's take a project. This is revision means your branch, or it could be your commit ID. So this is a typical line. It says that the project is going to be Tavik. This is the project name. It's going to check out the revision Q3 file. And this is it. Revision is something which is either a branch name or it could be a commit ID. So we'll move on to next slide. Okay, so how to download the code? How to actually use repo tool? So this is the list of command to actually download the code. You will see that this repo init. Repo init is something where you specify your project your main host server where your projects are listed. -NB is for which branch you want to check out. It could be a possibility that you started with 235, now then you move to 237, and now with ICS you have moved to 4.0. But and you have maintained your code as a separate branch. So it's like you can check out, okay, I want to check out 235. So you specify -B, your branch name. -M is manifest file, as I've shown you earlier. It will tell you what projects to check out and what commit IDs to check out. This first command, repo init, it doesn't download, it just initializes your download. It will check for the existence of this project, if it is there or not. It will ask for your name, it will ask for your email address and anything else. And this repo sync is the command which actually will start download. Here in this example, I'm checking out ICS code, Ice Cream Sandwich code, from Android's official channel. Now the code structure, okay. How it looks like is, once you have downloaded the code, this is how the directory structure looks like. You will find a couple of these, few of these directories, binet, bootable, build. Okay, the cscope.out and tags is not a part of USB. This is something which is something to do with me. I have created these files. So in this section, I'll be briefly covering what all these directories are there for. First, we'll start with binet. Okay, so sorry. Okay, binet is Android's C library. It is different from a GCC library. They have their own modifications. Essentially, they wanted to move out of GCC because of licensing things, plus a couple of features which they have added. Second directory is bootable. This is a legacy directory. No one uses it anymore. People use it only for reference. Only for reference because it contains fastboot code, which has to go in your bootloader if you are planning to have fastboot. So this is only for reference. Third directory, build, is an important directory. This is the directory which comes into picture when you actually do a build. So when you do a make and you specify your target platform, then how your Android build takes those parameters. This is how, I mean, that whole thing is configured in this build directory. I'll be covering this directory later. CTS is Android's compatibility test suite. This is something which has nothing to do with porting, but it is important if you are planning to have Android Market in your system, in your device. This is a test suite which you have to pass if you are planning to have your device certified. Okay, that you can say, okay, that's how it goes is that you say my device is 99% CTS compatible or 100% CTS compatible. When you go to Google and you say, okay, my device is Android compatible, I need Android stamp on it. That okay? Okay. It is capable of running Android Market and other proprietary things, licensing things actually. Tavik contains your Tavik virtual machine code. Development contains your test cases, mainly tutorials, monkey code. Device is again an important directory from a coding point of view, because all the vendor specific, all the target specific directories, all the target specific files will go into device. External directory is again an important directory. External directory hosts all the projects which are directly or indirectly or not at all developed by Google. So you will find, you know, Bluetooth, WPA supplicant, Skia, everything which is not directly related to Google in this directory. Framework is your base, your Android core application framework, your service managers, your all the daemons, all the services which you run is essentially a part of this framework directory. Hardware is your hardware specific, you will find all the hardware specific libraries, modules here. Kernel is Linux kernel. Libcore contains your Apache Harmony code, which is a kind of a complement code to some Java. NDK is the development kit. Packages is AOSP, stock applications, which comes as a part of AOSP. Prebuild contains your prebuild binaries, mainly toolchains. SDK is Android Software Development Kit. You are most probably aware of this, what SDK is. System is something very important. Some system contains your Android's core system libraries or binaries. When Android system boots up, initial few binaries which Android runs is a part of system library. So this is something which may be of interest for you. Okay, I wanted to have a quick look into Android kernel, because if you find all these development boards or any other board, or any board if you get a hands on, they release only a stock kernel. They release Linux kernel, they don't release Android kernel. For example, if your device is on 2.6.38 kernel, but upstream your device can support 3.1 kernel. Now, 3.1 kernel is a vanilla kernel, it doesn't have your Android patches. So, what is the process to get those Android patches, put it in your latest kernel, and then just run it? So, how it works is, okay, so this is that history I'm talking about. Android or Google, it maintains an Android common tree. This common tree is hosted by Google in their Git repository. So what they do is they put all their Android patches on top of Linus's base tree. For example, if this Android common is on 3.1, so what it essentially means is that he has taken Linus's 3.1 kernel and then applied its 400 or 470 patches on top of it, and it has released it as a common tree. So once this is done, all you have to do is just extract the patches. If you are not aware of how to do it, there are a couple of git commands through which you can specify that, okay, give me the patches starting from this commit ID, and that commit ID is going to be Linus's commit ID. So it will extract all the patches on top of that patch, and it will give you a list. Then you have to apply all those patches on your device's kernel. I'll quickly go through the Android kernel features. Binder is Android's IPC mechanism. It is mainly used for, it's an IPC mechanism. So, how the services talk to each other, how the transaction flows. HMM is anonymous shared memory, also sometimes known as Android shared memory. Then we have logger. Logger is an important thing because it is the driver which maintains your system logs. And now when I'm talking about system log, I'm essentially talking about four types of logs. Android driver, this logger driver maintains four buffers. One buffer is for your system logs, another buffer is for your radio logs, one is for your event logs, and one is your kernel logs. So this is something which is very handy when I'm going to cover the debugging section, because that is where you dump those logs. That is where you specify, okay, I want to see my radio is not working fine, I want to see what is going wrong there. So instead of just dumping all the four buffers, you can specifically dump radio logs. Wake logs is it's an Android feature which prevents a system to enter suspend or low power states. How it works is that from your application or from your native service, you request for a wake log. And once you have a wake log acquired, that means that system is not going to sleep and it is not going to sleep. So you can do whatever you want to do, and then you have to just release it. Once you have released the wake log, it can go to suspend mode. Out of memory handler, this is something which application developers are very, very, very well aware of. What it does is that if it finds your system is going out of memory, so it starts killing process based on their priority level. Now this priority is something which you set in your init.rc file. I'll be covering what that init.rc file is. Alarm is Android's alarm timer. RAM console is again something which is helpful in debugging. Paranoid network is Android's term where you can only play around your network settings if you have a particular user ID or a group ID, namely which is a root ID. Okay, so here we are, Android hardware abstraction layers. As I told you, hardware abstraction layers are that part of code which sits in between your framework and kernel. So your framework can talk to your hardware abstraction layer, and then it will talk to your kernel and your hardware. Now here, what I have covered is, I have covered that part of code where your hardware abstraction layer is hooked to your Android framework. So how it works is that you can see this star hardware interface. Now what does this star hardware interface means is that your interfaces have, your C++ class has exposed interface class which could be camera hardware interface, it could be audio hardware interface. So once you have this hardware interface implemented, you have to implement your hardware abstraction layer, and then your application framework will call this hardware get module or this DL open, dynamic linking. So how it works is, in that hardware get module, you specify that my module name is this. If you see see the usage of this function, it requires a tag and then some other parameters. So based on that tag, it will load the module. It will search for your hardware abstraction layer in the runtime space. Second thing is, how hardware abstraction layers are linked to framework is, one thing is this runtime binding, where you just open the library or you use hardware get module function or you use dynamic linking. Second option is to do a build time linking. At build time, you specify, okay, I'm linked to this module. So at runtime, it will load these modules. Third is the standard Linux SFS or / dev node entries, where you just open the SFS entries, write into it, and then let the driver take care of everything. So in this case, there will not be any specific library in between. Your framework can directly talk to your driver. This is what happens in case of Wi-Fi. If you guys have worked on Wi-Fi or something like this in Android coding, there is no firmware in between. Oh, firmware is there. There is no hardware abstraction layer in between. So what it does is, it just writes to some certain SFS entries, and it just let the driver take care of everything. Firmwares here are different from hardware abstraction layers. I just used firmware, but don't get confused. Firmwares are not hardware abstraction layers. Okay, so I'll be covering Android build process. These are the generic commands which you just run and you expect them to work straight away. First command sets up your build environment. So this is that build directory I was talking about. What it consists of is build code. This is the top level main file. It does nothing. It can do anything. It's just a main file. So you can configure your targets here. By default, there are no targets defined here. It will just include build core main.mk, which is this. Now, here you will find different targets defined. I'm assuming that people are aware of makefiles. So, what are targets and how makefile works? So this droid, if you see, droid is a default target. So if you are not specifying any specific target, it's going to assume droid. Okay, I'm going to build droid. What droid means that it's going to build your system images, your user data images, but not kernel, because kernel is not part of droid. Okay, so this is something which you can check it out later. This is the command which we run. You know, this is the script which initializes your build. So if you see, it exports certain binaries like MMM, it exports your target products, it exports your configurations which is present here, build core config.mk. See, this file contains your build configurations, which are the default build configurations. Okay, so this is it mostly. They have specified the toolchain path. What is the default toolchain you want to use? For example, you don't want to go with this toolchain. You have your own toolchain. Because this is what we do in Linux. We are always on top of the latest GCC toolchain. We use GCC toolchain to build. So we just modify this part. We specify, okay, we are going to use 4.6 toolchain. Now after running the first command, it will export certain variables. One of the variable is lunch. What lunch does is, lunch help you choose what target product you want to build for. Target product is something which you specify for your product. I'll be coming to this later. Then while building, you can use C cache. This is mainly used to cache object files, because AOSP build is a huge process. It, on a normal machine, it takes around 4 to 6 hours. If you are sharing that machine with someone else, and if you are using this variable, that means those object files are already cached. For the next person who is going to do a build, it's not going to take that much time, because it has already cached certain object files. But limitation here is that it only caches C and C++ object files. So all the Java files is something which you have to build again later. Then you have got make command, which will just start your build. MMM or MMM commands are mainly make commands, but they are mainly used to build independent projects. So, because Android has only one top level make file, it doesn't have separate make files for independent projects. Independent projects come with a make file called android.mk. Which is not a standard makefile, it is Android's makefile. So you can find the Androidization there. So you use these commands, MMM, when you specify target product. So these M or MM, they know what Android.mk is.
I have a question.
Yeah?
See, regarding this make, I
think
the next year specified, right? I remember reading one of the forums that the X value can be the number of threads in your code. If it's a
yes.
Single thread,
yeah.
Single code, so you can give make minus J2.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they say if it's two threads in a single code, you can also give minus J4. And here you've written plus one.
Yes.
So it's all a little confusing for me.
See, ideally you should not give plus four for a single code.
Dual thread.
Okay, yes, then you can do, yes.
Should you give
dual thread,
do you give -J2 or do you give -J4?
You can give up to -8. You can give whatever
you want to do, but
it's not going to use it. So there's a limit on the number of threads it can spawn.
So basically, if I give the number of threads, it should be good enough.
Number of threads plus one. This is what people recommend.
Would you know why that plus one?
I have no idea. Seriously. But instead of giving just any number, what people recommend is just give number of threads your CPU is capable of plus one.
This is regarding with the Android architecture.
Okay.
You mentioned about the external folder is containing the
yeah.
C or normal library permissions for Android. Suppose I want to add new service or new application there.
Uh-huh.
So open SSL.
Okay.
What are the procedures for compiling the things with the common mainstream core?
Okay. So, if you are planning to do it as a service,
yeah.
Right? So, it has to go in framework.
Yeah, but if you are presenting the next file, or if you take the matrix form.
Sorry?
You are making the entry in the next file of the this entry file for billing handler.
Okay, so
there, or
no, you have to make the entry in your board configuration file. There is a variable called product underscore packages.
Okay.
So in your device configuration files, you specify ki, apart from the default packages, I want to build these many packages.
Okay.
Okay. So I will cover this thing in next session.
Yeah, fine.
Right. So how to add your own project. But as far as the service thing is goes, service specific part is a Java JNN part, so it should go to framework. It should not be in external. I mean, it should not be. You can put it everywhere, but it should not be. Okay, so I have shown you these build configuration files. Build core main config product.mk product underscore config.mk. These are just for reference. If you want me to, show you.
Which
I have already shown
to you. Okay, so I don't have enough time, I think. I'll just go through my slides.
Summary here is that you have to export these three variables out. Product device, target product, and target device. Now, these variables are something which you have to define in your board configuration files. I will directly jump to board configuration files because those are something which is very important. But these are the ones. First thing, the first line, you say that the build time configuration files are Android products, board config, and Android board.mk. This android.products.mk is the file which will specify all your board specific files. So for example, I'm building for panda board, I'm going to go with panda board.mk. Now, then you specify my product device and other things. Now comes your board configuration file. Okay, so this is where you specify your build options specific to your target. For example, for a new device, if I have a new device, what I do is I will build it with all the stubs. I will try to make sure that the basic, the core of Android comes up. Audio is not working, I'm not worried about. Camera is not working, I will just use stubs. So what I do is, instead of using these, also audio and this, I will use this. Board uses generic audio. Similarly, I will use board has a camera stub. So this is something which you can, these are build time configurations for your target which you can specify here. Okay. Mm-hmm. After these build configuration files, there are runtime configuration files like init.rc and other things. Init.rc is just a script. It's like Android's own small scripting language where it specifies certain triggers. Triggers are like early boot. What should Android do in early boot phases? What it should do after it boots up? What it should do in the initialization phase? So. Okay, so this is what I am talking about, on init, on boot, these are all triggers. So what it does is, look, these are just commands. Change the ownership, change the permissions. And at the end is the fun part. This is where Android initialization starts. So this is it. We specify the number of the services which we want to run. So services this, service that, service this. You can see WPS applicant, native daemon and everything else. So that is our in.rc. Similarly, you have certain runtime configuration files. This is that optional product.m, which is a package which I'm talking about, that you have, if you are planning to add extra package, then this is where you have to add it. Now the Android boot process, I will just go through it quickly. Android kernel will start the init process. Init will go through the init.rc script, and then it will start your all the services and all the commands which I listed there. It will start Zygote. Zygote is your first process, not the first process technically, but the process which will initialize your Dalvik VM and spawn other processes. Then it will go all the services I mentioned in that init.rc. Zygote will start the system server. System server will start all the services. Now this all the services, I don't have time to show you the code, but it's in framework-based services, Java, and system server.java. So you will find that there it is starting all these services line by line. Once these services are up, essentially your system is up. Now how other applications get spawned? Applications are spawned by Zygote, Dalvik, which is your launcher. Android application talks to other services. Now how these services talk to each other is that the service manager I have mentioned specifically because the service manager is the context manager. Context manager means it is the one who is going to do the IPC, who is going to initiate the IPC. So, you talk to service manager talk to binder, it will reply back and it will talk to your application. Okay, so Android debugging and troubleshooting, these are commonly used tools. Most important thing is to get the logs as much as possible. So in init.rc, I have shown you that there is something called log level, which you can increase. So more you increase the log level, more dumps you will get. Dmsh is your kernel log. Logcat gives dumps your system logs. Four types of logs. Just almost done. ADB, DDMS, you might be aware of it. Okay, this is an interesting thing. Proc last dmsh, what it does is it stores your last dmsh in this file, so which you can retrieve in the next boot. TraceView is something to debug Android applications. And for help, you have all these Android communities, you have IRC channels, you have Linaro forums, robot forums, where you can ask your question and people will get back to you. So, any questions?
Okay, one question. Yeah, basically, since you touched upon using initialization.
Okay.
Now, I don't know if it comes in Logcat. I just want to know. Say, for example, I've got an ADPK file. I'm doing an ADP push of an APK file. I have another ADP shell open. Okay, it's linked to the same emulator. And I do a Logcat. Can I see what is happening in terms of that app being installed?
Yes, you can.
But I couldn't, so I don't know what the problem was. Maybe if our app was a little...
Because I've checked things like this, and you do get logs. You'll get the prints like, just download it to your system, unzipping, and restarting that APK, unzipping that APK, starting that APK. So this kind of log is something which I've seen while installing APK file.
Okay, but I know increase log levels. I have not done anything to increase the log
levels.
It's the default log level
being set. Okay.
So it should come either ways.
It should come either ways, yes. Because log levels are mainly for init level log levels. And if you are doing a logcat, and if you are using any level which is above debug level, then it should come. Debug or warnings, errors, so they should come. So it's actually based, it depends on your APK or your application. While starting, how many messages it is dumping. If it is not dumping anything, you will not get anything.
Okay.
So, handle.